Heart Talk. Good afternoon and welcome to all the participants to Heart Talk. This is a weekend talk show we've been having for the last month or so now, where we bring in a leading personality from a non-financial industry. As you know, from Monday to Friday, we generally have some subject matter experts from the financial industry. As you also know, that this is our way of showing solidarity, the frontline warriors, be it the medical staff, the police, or citizens, NGOs who are fighting the COVID virus. And so this is our way of bringing all of us together in some platform and exchanging meaningful information. So today, in Heart Talk, we have none other than Mr. Danish Kodi Sachidanandan. He was the DGP. Hello?
Shivanandan.
Sorry, Danish Kodi Shivanandan. He is one of India's most well-known and highly regarded Indian police service. Instead of me giving you the introduction, I have a short video about him. So could you please play his video? Mr. Shivanandan, video please.
Sir, I can't play.
No, not you, sir. My back office will pay it.
Okay.
Just a minute. It'll come up now. So no. Meanwhile, while it comes, I want to tell you that we are live on this platform, that is EPS. We're also live on Twitter, Facebook, and YouTube. So these are the four channels where today people are watching us and hearing us. So while that comes up, sir, a couple of questions, sir. So there it is, the line.
Shivanandan started his career as a professor in the Madras University. He found his true calling in IPS and joined the Maharashtra cadre. During his tenure, he was posted at several places all over the state.
State intelligence and the intelligence bureau for 6 years. Then 6 years in the Mumbai crime branch. Yes. And 3 years in the Naxalite area as the deputy inspector general of police. And 3 years as the joint director CBI West Zone. And then 6 years as commissioner of police. I was not only for Mumbai, I was there before Nagpur. Mm. And then Thane for 3.5 years.
His most notable contribution was during his stint as the additional commissioner in the Mumbai crime branch, where the underworld was thriving in the city of Mumbai and brought it to its knees.
When I had just joined here, there were 20 shootouts in a month. There was definitely a complete fear psychosis gripping the city. Marriages were not taking place. Restaurants used to close early in the evening. Everybody was putting himself in the shoes of a victim.
At the time, my job I assigned to myself was to stop the blood flowing on the streets. 1,600 guns were removed and 1,600 approximately of detentions, which the police commissioner had the power.
We have sent an appropriate signal now in Mumbai that crime does not pay.
A very popular Bollywood movie, Company, was also made starring Mohanlal as Shivanandan. After another massive blow to the city of Mumbai, the terror attacks of 2611, Shivanandan was brought to take charge as the commissioner of the city and revamp the whole system and prepare it in case of another such eventuality.
I went to Israel, met the commander-in-chief, brought a trainer and trained 1,500 men in Pune and other places to form part of the QRT. We have got a Force One, which I helped in grooming and developing. I spent so much money on them. There are 235 of them. And then we have a NSG, 235 of them waiting in Marol. So with this kind of help, the men, when I joined, they said, we will do anything. The commandos who are existing, they said, we'll do anything. We'll barge in and take action against them.
After retiring as the Director General of Police Maharashtra, he continued his fight to save the city. This time for the hungry, with his initiative, the Roti Bank.
So I have seen how the street children are now going around and not getting any adequate help and food and education and all that. And I also thought that this poverty and this kind of a thing growing at this rate can increase crime rate. If you want to control crime as a cop, I thought we should take care of these people and also ameliorating this poverty, which is going galloping kind of a thing.
Let us salute this great man for all his continued contributions to the city of Mumbai and the nation.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Mr. Shivanandan. That was great. Sir, I can surely call you the super cop of Mumbai because thank you for all that you have done for the citizens while in duty. And now you have taken social responsibility. You have taken to feed the poor, you know. So it's like a great journey from a police to now the serving in the social sector. While we have a presentation which we can play, while that is getting ready, may I ask you one question, sir? Are you from a family of police? Are you? Yeah.
No, my nobody actually was in the government service when I was studying and all that. My father was in the Maharashtra Madras Electricity Board, and I was brought up with the hope that I would become a professor in the university. Because I was fond of reading books all the time, reading newspapers and all that. And the last job I would have ever imagined to be fit for would be the police. So I was a softie in the house that way. So so they would have never imagined in the wild that I would become a cop. But then what happened? I became a professor to fulfill the prophecy. And I was teaching economics in the University of Madras for 3 years. But I got bored in between teaching the same thing to the same boys, you know, same type of boys. So I said, let us do something adventuristic. So I appeared for UPSC, which included IAS, IPS, IAS, and all that. But then I was going every day by Blue Mountain Express to Chennai, give one exam, come back, teach, then go back again. So in that bargain, in the first attempt, I cleared only IPS. Nothing regretting about it. And I joined without knowing what is the big difference between IAS, IPS, IFS and all that, because salary is the same. When I joined, it was the same. When I retired, it's the same as the chief secretary. But the boredom which I felt, I got into a roller coaster ride. You know, that's a fantastic thing which happened to me. But as Martin Luther King said, now he's being remembered with the riot in USA, that if you are going to be a cleaner, clean it so well that people will come and take a comb and comb your hair. So that's what I did as a policeman. I combed the whole society and made it so clean. There's no crime, organized crime in Mumbai city. Since the last 20 years, not a single shootout by the police or by the criminals. That is what happened to me being a professor and becoming a policeman. That's it. No connection to police or government service at all in my family. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. So let's play the video. So surely you are like from a super cop, you have become now a superman with, you're doing so much of work for the society. So while the video is getting ready to be played, so, as a South Indian, how did you manage to come to Maharashtra as the DGP of Maharashtra?
You know, that's a good question you're asking. When Sardar Vallabhai Patel was making the constitution, he wanted to be, the integration of the country was his prime in his mind. So like the earlier British time, the IP used to be the Indian Police Service and the ICS was the IAS. So when the country got independence, they made IAS, IPS and Indian Forest Service as the service mentioned in the constitution of the country. This is to retain the integrity of the country so that it will not become independent and to give a fair deal of administration to people. So 50% of the jobs in a state would go to the outsiders. So I, as an outsider, I was allotted in a kind of a lottery, kind of, it's called roster. In that system, I got tossed into Maharashtra. When I came to Maharashtra, neither I knew Hindi nor I knew Marathi. I learned it all on the streets. That's how I landed up in That was in the year 1976. Since then, I never went back anywhere.
Right.
I did my intelligence bureau, my CBI, my IB, everything sitting in Maharashtra. But I did the Government of India jobs also here only. But then I speak fluent Marathi like any Maharashtrian would do. I read daily 10 newspapers even today, Lok Satta, Maharashtra Times, blah, blah, blah. So I'm very well versed in Marathi now.
Absolutely, sir. Wonderful. Sir, great, great to know. May I request my back office to please play the video?
So, sir, can I start, sir?
Yes, please. Go ahead.
Can I start? Okay. 20 to 25 minutes I'm going to take. So, I'm going to talk about disruptions have come. For example, coronavirus is a disruption. And inventing insulin was a disruption. Finding a vaccine for corona would be a disruption. Finding computers was a disruption. And Kodak has gone away and Xerox has gone away. Now mobile phones have come and eliminated 30 instruments which we used. So this kind of disruptions became a catalyst for change. Today in 20 minutes, I'm going to show how one man, when everything else is remaining the same, how one man can come and change and become a disruptor and become a catalyst for change, development, economics, banking, everything to develop, one man. So to be successful, I told you earlier, like Martin Luther King, your focus has to be like a crazy man. Next, please. You have to work like a crazy man. Success does not come. You have to fight it out of your mind and you have to create success. And life is like a block of stone. All the excess dust, if you remove, you find yourself to be a fantastic statue. So you have to remove all the dust around you to become successful. Go out into the world with your passion and love for what you do and just never give up. At this stage, hold on for a minute. I wanted to tell all the people who are viewing, the bankers, I suppose, that if you want to become the best in the banking or in any line, even if you join IPS, IAS tomorrow, because if you are below the age, you can try. I suggest you all try. You should have 7 qualities. Since this is a management lecture, I would like to give you take home points right from the beginning. 1, have a great vision about yourself. Please hold on. Don't move the slides. Great vision. 2 is a passion for doing whatever you do. These are what is mentioned in this slide. 3 is the courage to call a spade a spade. If something is going wrong, say that and get sacked for that. But you'll be known for your courage. So 3 is the courage. 4 is the character. Sterling character. Absolute character. People should remember you for your honesty. The next one is competence. Qualify, read, qualify all the time until the last day on the earth, not on the retirement day. I retired 10 years before, even now I joined a fintech course and I'm also studying every day. So read until the death. So that is another point. Next is self-image. Have a fantastic self-image. Think big. You're a great man. You're going to be the CEO. You're going to be the prime minister. The man who allegedly was selling tea in Ahmedabad has become the prime minister, an internationally recognized statesman, and there is no parallel to him now. So that is the kind of a self-image you should have. The last but not the least is the discipline. For doing all the above, you should have complete focus on discipline. I want to mention about a book written by James Collins. It is called The Level 5 Leadership. He interviewed 1,465 top level CEOs and came to a conclusion that humility, being humble, is one of the best four characteristics of all these people. Innovative, risk-taking, various other things come later. But the best of the CEOs were found to be humble. With this, I go and tell my own story as a case study for you people to be a winner, taking risk, risking your life, risking your job, going to jail. With all that, how you can change the whole system and bring about peace and become a successful entrepreneur or some successful bureaucrat. This is the story I'm going to tell you in the next few minutes. 16 minutes I have. Go ahead. Please go ahead. Now, these are the gangsters, you know, Karim Lala and the Haji Mastan and various others. today, please hold on. This Daud Ibrahim is allegedly dead, they say in the news. It is false, actually. He is alive. He is son of a Havaldar of Mumbai police. He is one sibling out of 12 children produced by the Ibrahim Havaldar. And none of them were educated. And this guy took to crime, petty crime. And then now he is worth about 40,000-50,000 crores. He stays in Karachi and he is not being, we are not able to annihilate him or apprehend him. And even the UN, he is the most wanted drug lord as per the UN drug administration, but he is not being caught. Abbottabad, they caught him, Osama bin Laden, but not this guy. So every now and then they say he is dead, but he is not. Even today in the news channel, they're showing he is dead. So that is the crime. He is the one who ruled this place even today. He's got a fantastic hold. The story I'm telling will be revolving around one of my Havaldar's son. He is Daud Ibrahim. Next. Abu Salam is another uneducated man from Pratapgarh. He came here and joined Daud Ibrahim, took part in the bomb blast of 1993 and then got caught. And then he went to Lisbon, escaped and went to Lisbon. We brought him. He fell in love with Monica Bedi and more beautiful woman from Bollywood because he made tons of money by blackmailing, extorting the Bollywood people. Now he is in custody. We brought him from Lisbon when I was in the CBI. He is undergoing jail for having killed one Pradeep Jain and participating in the 1993 blast. Next. Chota Rajan was a partner of Daud Ibrahim. If you all see a movie called Company, which was shown there in my introduction, where Mohanlal plays as Shivanandan, how these two guys have come up and they blasted the whole country. And on 12th March 1993, there were 12 blasts in Mumbai where 257 people died and 857 people were injured. Hundreds of crores worth of property was blown up. This was done by these people together. Afterwards, he left him out and went to Cambodia and Malaysia and started his own criminal empire. Recently, he surrendered at Bali, and then he has come to Tihar jail and he is sitting there and he is getting himself cured and he is under protection. So many crimes are coming for trial and he is getting conviction of 10 years and 12 years and things like that. His wife is here in Chembur. His children are studying here and that is the story of Chota Rajan. And 8 criminals belonging to that bomb blast, he shot them in Mumbai Road by claiming that the government cannot give them punishment, I will give it to them. So he became the official Hindu don of the country. Next. So this is Izaz Lakadawala, belonging to Chota Rajan gang. He's a Muslim, but then he was targeting the Bollywood and he was shot about 8-10 years before in the brain in Bangkok, but he survived and he started targeting the Bollywood. Now he has been brought, arrested. He's there in the crime branch custody and he's telling so many stories. Next. Arun Gavli is a gangster turned MLA and he was always in the jail, but he declared a VDIS of 4 crores. His daughter is a corporator. His another daughter got married just now. He came out on bail. Just now he is in jail for a murder called a man called Jamson Dekar. So he's a criminal turned politician. So that is how you should understand how things change in this country. His sister's son is Sachin Ahir. He was partner with him, but he has become a minister. He's adorning a lot of chairs as MMRDA chief and this one, that one and all that. Tons of money for these guys because they have joined the politics. Next. This is Ashwin Naik's brother, a BJTI graduate. And then he was shot in the court and became paralyzed waist below. And he went to Canada and London and then Delhi and then started a narcotic business. While doing that, he shot his wife, Geeta, in Mumbai for being non-loyal to him. And then he came back, got all the cases acquitted. He's moving around. Just now, he's arrested for another MCOCA case and he's in the jail. He is waist below paralyzed. Next. This man shot that Sunit Katao, mill owner of Katao. And then later on in a police operation, Salaskar had done an operation and on the 10th of August, he was shot dead by the police in an encounter. Next. This is a displaced mill worker's son, Lalbagh, where I stay. This guy ruled the place and got a lot of extortion, went to Belgaum and built a huge mansion and lived there on one of the police operations on the 15th August 2003 in Kolhapur. He had passed away. It was a police operation. Next. He's another man. He's alive in Sabarmati Jail. But he did the JJ Hospital shootout in 1992. A tall 6.3 footer went with the AK-47s and fired so many rounds for killing two accused who were in the custody of seven policemen. It became a famous case that time because to do terrorism like that was something unthinkable. Later, when I was joint CP, we took up the case for trial, got him a hanging as punishment, but he got into appeal. He got only a life sentence. He's enjoying that life sentence there in Ahmedabad. And he's making money by doing chota mota extortion also. Next. Pablu Srivastav is the kidnapping king. He never took less than 5 crores. And Umesh Shroff of Hayat Regency, Delhi. And here, Mittal Builders, Vishwanath Mittal, Dilip Bafna, and so many people. He's in the jail, but he's writing books and making movies and falling in love and marrying and all that. But then he selected only the convent-educated, college-going Delhi University boys and paid them 25 lakhs of rupees for each case they done, each kidnapping they done. He's alive and he's doing the job from the jail. Can you believe that? Next. Next, please. So these are the daredevil at the courtroom. They came to the courts and shot them when the court was working. And then police was there. But then the government and the police were wringing their hands and they didn't control anything. How we control them later is the story I'm trying to tell you. Next one. Next one. Babu Rashim was killed in the police lockup on 8th March at Jacob Circle. Police were surrounding him. They were protecting him and still he was shot. Next one. Datta Samant was killed. He is a trade union leader. He is not a gangster. But he was killed right outside the house. He was terrorizing the owners of the mills and he was done to death by the others in Mumbai. I am trying to tell you how they terrorized Mumbai city and the business people. That's the story I am weaving. Next. Gulshan Kumar is a T-series guy, about 500 crore, 800 crores, bhakta of Vaishno Devi. He built a temple in Mumbai. He went to worship on 12th August 1997. Abu Salem, whom you saw in the earlier picture, he shot him. Nadeem and Shravan, who were making music, were involved in that. Nadeem went away to London. We tried to bring him for trial. We could never bring him because extradition did not work for him. Vijay Mallya may be brought, but not Nadeem Shravan. Next. Nadeem, not Shravan. Rama Nayak is another gangster and he was killed there and changed the history. Next. Maniya Surve is a shootout at Wadala. If you have seen that movie, you have seen I'm Cutting Short the Time. John Abraham made him immortal. Next one. This is the shootout at Lokhandwala. Mr. A.A. Khan did that. 6 of them, Maya Dolas and others. Lot of controversies. A movie has been made. You could see that and live those days. Thousands of bullets fired. Next. So these are the builders who were killed. They are all worth thousands of crores. Om Prakash Kukreja, Vallabh Thakkar, Pradeep Jain and all that. What I want you to know is, because of the operations and the story I am telling, after 1998 or 1999, no builder has been shot. That is how all the tall towers in Worli and here in Lower Parel and Parel are coming because of the operations done by the Mumbai police. Next. These are the hoteliers. In one way or the other, they were involved or otherwise, but they all paid the price for hobnobbing with the gangsters and they laid down their lives. Next. These are the other hoteliers, 12, 13 of them. After 2001, as my story goes, no one has been shot. Next. These are the film people. If you see, Rakesh Roshan was shot. He's alive. Manmohan Shetty is alive. Anil Tadani is alive. Rajiv Roy was alive. But some of them have been dead. So in that, Mukesh Dugal will come and things like that. But they terrorized and took money. Allegedly, Abu Salem has got $40 million even now in the banks. But they have not been able to bring it out. Next. So in summarizing, gangsters ruled Mumbai, businessmen were killed in dozens. 101 businessmen in the year 98. That means every 3.5 days, one top businessman was shot dead on the road. Building industry collapsed because there were no purchasers. Police morale was low because of an encounter petition filed by Abu Azmi. Car sales were zero because when you bought a car, they demanded money. And marriage venues were shifted because you did a marriage and they demanded money. Next. So this is the encounter petition. Not only one encounter was considered a false and a murder by a judge, inquiring judge A.S. Aguiar. He also decided 95 others were false. Because of that, Mumbai police went into complete hibernation. They didn't do any action. Because of that, the earlier figure I showed, that 101 businessmen were shot in 1 year, it is because of this freezing that happened. So the whole strategy was to defreeze the policeman, win this case, and bring back Mumbai under the safety net of the law and order and the constitution of the country. Next. So this is a turnaround story. Next. Strategy without tactics is the slowest route to victory, and tactics without strategy is a noise before defeat. I beseech all of you to read Sun Tzu, The Art of War, also The Prince by Machiavelli, and also Chanakya, and also Thirukkural, if anybody knows Tamil. If these things you read, you will be a master of strategies. Next. So I borrow from Bruce Lee. 2 inches less was his one leg. It's hell of a big handicap for him. But he said, hell with the circumstances, I create opportunities. And thus, he became a legend. Next. So we enacted a new law called the Maharashtra Organized Crime Control Act. And I implemented it also. A film owner, film producer called Bharat Shah was arrested. 19 months he was in jail. He spent 100 crores on getting out of the clutches of the law. But he got a conviction even today. A sitting judge called J.W. Singh, 28 months he was in jail. Then we did the electronic intelligence gathering through telephone tapping of the Pakistan, Cambodia, Malaysia and all that. Very valuable information came. Because of that, we could neutralize a lot of gangsters. Alert Citizen Scheme was one of them. Next. These are winning that encounter petition which I showed you earlier. We won in Mumbai High Court. And 14 years later in the Supreme Court also we won. Because of that, there is a clear direction of the Mumbai High Court and the Supreme Court as to how, if at all, anything has to be done in an encounter, what are the rules and regulations to follow. Building a winning team, you are all managers. I built a fantastic winning team. And then later, resources for the police for all the operations is a must. You have to give the wherewithal. So we did that. Next. So these are all professionally qualifying policemen to do excellence. We did that. We sharpened the knife before cutting the trees or before going to the war, polish all the guns and make the gunpowder ready. This slide shows about that. Next. This is the strategy. Multi-pronged attack on mafia. Detention. Detention is Mumbai Police Commissioner can detain a criminal under certain circumstances for 1 year. We detained 1,700 of them. So ladies and gentlemen, if there is any lady there, 1,700 man years of criminals were spent behind the bars in 3 years. Obviously, the crime would come down. So if anyone says that only encounter reduced the crime, it is not true. Detentions also reduced crime. The last, if you see diagonally down below, 2,000 firearms were seized. They were all illegal weapons. Each fellow, Tom, Dick and Harry, would carry an AK-47 and brandish it. We saw to it that nobody will took out a gun and stayed alive. So 2,000 weapons we recovered, and thus we mopped up the entire gun culture completely. On the side, you can see extortionists were detained, so extortions came down. Gangsters like Subhash Singh Thakur was arrested, so that gangsterism came down. And encounters is also part of the story. Encounter is nothing but a lawful activity under 100 section of the Indian Penal Code, where a police officer goes to arrest and the other man shoots him, and then in self-defense, a well-armed, well-prepared police force fires. That is an encounter in a romanticized Bollywood way. But a lot of policemen have died. Butla encounter in Delhi is known to you, movie is there. So we also lay down our lives. It is not that it is always one-sided. Next. So here you can see, these are the encounters. So we can see the number of incidents and the number of men killed. Sum total is that after 2002, except one case of J. Day, journalist killed in 2014, there is not a single shootout, and that is the success story I'm telling you. What is the success story? You have to be a leader, you have to be well informed, you have to study the law, and you have to implement the majesty of law, you have to provide the resources to the people, lead them from the front, be a role model, be an honest man, with that, the story gets completed. Next. So this is the criminals had killed so many people. I told you 98, 101 business people were shot dead every 3.5 days. That was hell for me. I was a joint CP crime. It was hell for me. But then you see the next year, it became half because of the dosage medicine we gave. Next year it became half. Next year it became half. Afterwards it is zero. So that is the turnaround. For that, you have to be prepared, you have to be honest, you have to be character has to be flawless, and people should feel that here is a role model worth following. Next. So these are the detention. I told you, 1 year detention, subject to the government approval and the High Court approval. In our case, 95% of cases were upheld by the High Court. So look at the number. This many thousand man years were spent behind the bars. Firearms, you can see, I told you 2,000. It is 2,200 or so weapons. They were AK-47s, hand grenades, and so many. Multiple weapons were brought in. But we rewarded them. We took care of the policemen. Encounter number is well known. Next. But encounter, it is absolutely legal. There is not a single case registered or inquired or filed against these encounters. So this is the result. You can see how, like fever coming down, how the murders came down with the firearms, and Mumbai felt relieved. Marriages are taking place, BMWs and Mercedes-Benz cars are sold, multi-floor housing schemes have come, people are having a fantastic life. Except the coronavirus, which I could not do anything about, all other things, we have given them the safety net for the Mumbaikers. Next, please. So knowledge is free. You only pay for ignorance. Even coronavirus, it is true of this. We apply this to coronavirus also, it will be applicable. Next. My ikigai is the reason why I am living after the police life. Next. So these children, I roti bank. I'm taking 2 minutes on roti bank. So these are the children, about 2,000 children we are feeding every day. And these are some of them, Drona Foundation of Dharavi. We give them freshly made food. Next one. So this is another NGO called Jeevan Dhara. We feed them also. Next one. This is again, nutrition is supreme so that they can go to the school, study, and crime control can be done. Next one. So Roti Bank is this. I want all of you to visit the website. Ladies and gentlemen, we have given 1.6 million meals from March 26th. Earlier, in 2018 and 19, I gave 1 million meals. In 2020, my target was 2 million meals in 12 months. Whereas in this 2 months alone, I am reaching 2 million meals. For the next of the 6 months, I'm going to target another million or much more. So it's a nation building activity. 400 million displaced workers are requiring food. Kindly join us. That's about it, sir. Don't go to the next one. I finished with that. With that, I thank you very much. And we can go to the question answer. Thank you. Thank you, sir. You gave me 25 minutes. I finished in 23 minutes, 48 seconds.
Yes, sir. Precise to the second, the discipline that you have. I think that was wonderful to hear, and the kind of thoughts that you have in tackling difficult situations is something that everyone has to learn. I mean, we may not be in police, but we have our own issues and things to tackle. And I think what you are talking about is something that we can all derive, we can learn, and you know, and try to be, you know, one of the things that you said is a best person is one who has humility in the strategizing it. I think that's a great takeaway for us. I want to say that, like I said, you are a super cop and now you become a Superman. You know, the transition was fantastic. I mean, it kind of highlighted your visions, and I'm happy that you have a target of close to 3 million lunch packets that you want to give. Just to go back, you know, what are the things that people do ask, you know, is you know, without mentioning anybody, is Encounter a right route?
Encounter is a right tool.
No, route. Is it a way? Route. I mean, is that a good thing to do? Or is it a bad thing to do?
I'll take it and give you a proper answer.
Yes.
Encounters are not arranged. Encounter is not a policy, and there is no word called encounter in any legal book or anywhere. This encounter is a fantasy, a romanticizing thing which is given by the Bollywood here in Mumbai. Yeah. And I would say, what is an encounter? If a girl and a boy meet in a park and sparks fly, then it is an encounter. In the same way,
if a criminal and a policeman meet each other, the criminal fires a shot or many, multiple shots, and the police fires. Whoever gets killed, that's an encounter. But people have a doubt. Why policemen don't die? Policemen do die. Many of them have died. But very few die, and very, very many criminals die because policemen are well trained, they have a statecraft, and they have been taught firing, and they have the bulletproof jackets and various other protection. And as I mentioned earlier, they have superior electronic intelligence. With that, they have the advantage. Why the criminals got emboldened? Because of the encounter petition, and the policemen were being tried for murder and all that. All of you remember that encounter which the police commissioner of Hyderabad, that is Sajanar, did when a girl was burnt alive after the rape. Four of them were taken out and shot. That is also an encounter. But there is a Supreme Court committee which is inquiring into that. He has to come out of that. In these things which I showed, numbering about 300 or so, they were perfectly legal as per the High Court directive or the Supreme Court. And no one was unnecessarily targeted. It was not a policy. It happened. When it happened, the policeman used Section 100 of the Indian Penal Code, under which even you all have the power to do an encounter. When you or anybody is targeted by someone to kill, in order to defend yourself, you can use the right of private defense and do whatever measure you want to save your life or the other's life. That is precisely called right of private defense. Please check on your Google phone. That is Section 100 of the Indian Penal Code. It authorizes. Even when a woman is going to be raped or kidnapped or various other things, she or her protector has the right to the extent of killing that person attempting to do that. That is where I said character and courage has to be an important element in our lives. If somebody is being raped or killed, we don't have to do a video and put it viral. We have to take serious action by intervening and saving the modesty of the woman. That is encounter, sir. There is no policy. There is no word like that. There is nothing. Legal sanction about it, except Section 100 of the Indian Penal Code, which empowers you also to do that. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you. So, you know, as you know, participants, ladies and gentlemen, you have an option to ask any question that you want. So you may frame a question, which is you put it in the Q&A box. The back office will look at it and will try to get the answers from Mr. Shivanandan. And you may also want to ask a direct question, which is also possible. Now, sir, while some of the participants will ask, I'm sure, some questions, there are three agencies that come readily come to my mind, which are very important and very helpful. One is the police, you have the CBI, and the intelligence. So how can you just briefly tell us, how do these three combine and work together?
They are all different, sir. Chalk and cheese is the difference between all of them. Police is the state's, entire law and order and crime control is the job of the state government. The central government has no locus standi to interfere in that. So CBI and IB are the government of India organizations. So the CBI came into being during World War II in order to inquire into the corruption charges against the people who are working in the government of India. Okay. CBI does not have a special act under which it works. It is still works under the Delhi Special Police Establishment Act. So CBI is working on as the handmaiden of the government of India. And as per law, in any state, before they investigate any case, they have to get a specific written permission from the state for their investigation. So if a Chandrababu Naidu or a Mamata Didi says CBI has no locus standi in my state, you cannot investigate, they cannot investigate. So CBI is meant for investigating basically corruption cases against the government of India, employees, PSU and various others, bankers and various others. Whereas Intelligence Bureau is the clock and dagger wala thing. If you read the spy stories, all the spying intelligence work they do, so they do the internal intelligence inside the government, inside the country, between Sri Lanka and Nepal and Bhutan and West, inside the country, they collect intelligence against labor movement, about workers movement or student movement or political movement, all that kind of thing, which impinges on the security of the country. They do collection and they brief the Prime Minister. The Director Intelligence Bureau called DIB meets the Prime Minister every day and briefs. It's a huge organization of 20,000 people. They are there all over the country and they collect intelligence. Parallel to them is the state intelligence bureaus, which are run by the state governments, and they also collect intelligence and provide to the CM. One more curious question you could ask is, what is R&AW? That is Research and Analysis Wing. We used to be part of the IB, Intelligence Bureau, and during Indira Gandhi's time, they separated it to call it for the external intelligence, like your Mossad or like your KGB or like your CIA of America. This equivalent is the R&AW in India. So they collect the external intelligence about Pakistan, China, Sri Lanka, Nepal, Bhutan, all that they cover, and they use technology. They use technology and various other methods. Thousands of books are there for you to read and regale yourselves. Recently, I saw a movie called Fauda in Netflix. I suggest all of you, all people, watch that. It's a fantastic thing based on intelligence, how the Israeli intelligence agencies work against Hamas. Mm-hmm. Please see that. Sir, I hope I have answered your question.
Yes, yes, sir. Could you repeat that title of the movie?
The title of the movie is Fauda, F-A-U-D-A, Fauda. It is a fabulous thing. It is worth every paisa and every minute. Everybody who is listening to me must watch that. It is about Israeli intelligence agency, how they risk, how they do for nation building. The other movie is that called Munich. If you've seen the movie called Munich, the book is, the original book is called The Vengeance. How the Palestinian criminals kill Israeli sports people in Munich in 1970, and how the Mossad people go and take revenge. That's the name of the, that's the theme of the story. Fantastic. The R&AW is also wonderful. They're also doing very well like that. But then they can't come out and write books and novels and sell and make movies out of that. There are restrictions about the celebrations by intelligence agencies.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. So good to know all that. Sir, we have a question for you. It could come from any social media channel. So the question is, how did you manage to achieve so much within the limitations of a bureaucratic environment?
What I have described is only one part of my life. The other one is that 2611, I became the commissioner of police after the Pakistani attack. That's another story, one other time. Given a choice, I will explain as to what all happened, how we built a world-class anti-terrorism thing. The other one is Naxalite area 3 years, 95-98, how Naxalism was fought against. So like that, variety of stories can be told. I've given you only one part of mafia control between 98-2001. How it was achieved, it was the need of the hour. And the government, the politicians were shot. Lot of BJP, Shishana, people were shot by the gangsters. The government had to survive under 356 of the Indian Constitution. A state government can be dismissed by the government of India as per law, as per the Constitution, when the law and order collapses in the state. So many governments have been dismissed by government of India. So it could have happened here also for collapsing of law and order of what I described. So that was the need of the hour. Somebody had to come and set it back. Believe me, whatever I have showed you, killings of people, killings of politicians and all that, happened from 1960, 1970, 1980, 1990 and 2000. So hundreds and thousands of them have been killed in the streets of Mumbai and other places. We had to put a full stop to that. How it was achieved? Vision, passion, character, and competence.
Competence, self-image, discipline.
That is
great. Fantastic.
Discipline and self-image. I can do it, you know. I can do it. If others can't do it, I can do it.
Fantastic, sir.
Information, everyone listening to me, I never took police protection when I was doing all these operations. I went alone, never carried a gun.
Oh, really? Okay.
That's it. Yeah. Believe. You believe yourself and then you surround yourself with honesty and integrity. You survive to tell a story like this.
Right, sir. Thank you, sir. So from police side, let's move to the social responsibility because that's the need of the hour. I mean, these COVID times when people are struggling, there is a lot more many people who are going hungry because of maybe they are displaced, maybe they are not getting their livelihood. So there are so many issues out there. So, you know, I would like to focus on that. So one question that comes to my mind is, how can people help the Roti Bank?
Sir, Roti Bank, in the last slide, I think I have given you the bank account. Mr. Mamalan has donated already to me. And we can do that. Paytm is there. So many other things. By visiting rotibankindia.org, the website, you know, you can pay. And you can give us grains, like just today, just now, before starting your presentation, I gave 2 tons of rice, 2 tons of atta, and 1 ton of dal to Raigad police for looking after these cyclone-ravaged people.
Okay, okay.
That kind of a thing you can give. You can give me rice, dal, and atta or oil. And that is where we make food and give it to 37,000 people a day. And when these migrant workers come back, they are not going to get salaries, this and that. They will need food. We are going to give it to them. On arrival, by the train, we will give. So I'm going to give them food for the next 6 months. And for the next 100 years, Roti Bank would be alive to bring up the small children from the streets and give them education and make them employable. Maybe they will become IAS, IPS officers and tell a story one day. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. So, ladies and gentlemen, it's not only about that you can donate money. Like you said, you can also donate in non-money forms. You can donate grains and other things that are required for food. It also is accepted by them.
So they can be sir, they can be volunteers.
Okay.
They can work for us. They can give us their time. They can come and serve food in certain areas. And they can also do a lot of publicity for us in the social media, like Twitter, Facebook, and various other places. They can carry the good word. For 20 rupees a meal, for 20 rupees, if a child can get a nutritious meal and study, I think it is worth the investment.
Absolutely, sir. So just to let you know, sir, we have also been, like I said earlier, we run this show every day. We talk to financial people and we do mention about Roti Bank. and tell them that you know, we have also been sponsoring, and that something that people should look at Roti Bank to you know, kind of contribute to them. So thank you for telling us that, and we will try to see how else we can promote Roti Bank. So you know, these are you are collecting food from various sources or making foods, and you know, how do you check for contaminated foods?
Sir, we had devised a system by the engineering college students called the Shah and Ankar Engineering College in Chembur. Mm-hmm. But then that works well only in the laboratory conditions. Okay. When my vehicle goes in the rumble and tumble of all these areas and collect food, that yes. machine, finely tuned machine, doesn't work. So mostly our own driver and helper to whom I pay, they test and taste the food to decide whether it is worth giving. But by and large, if you ask me, 85-90% of food we give is produced fresh.
Okay.
We are not getting this kind of food worth giving from all the five-star hotels and all the multi-billionaires parties. You know the names of the people who spend hundreds of crores. They don't give because their parties go up to 3 o'clock or 4 o'clock in the morning. And when yeah. was the food made and when they are going to give it to us, why that poor guy is going to wait throughout the night waiting for such food? No, it's not possible. So we operate from 9 o'clock to 10 o'clock in the night. Mostly these days, I give fresh food cooked by us. Okay. My food in Tata Cancer Hospital or in the schools and in the orphanages and old age home consists of roti, rice, dal and sabji. No non-vegetarian, no dairy products, no sweets, no diabetes.
Okay, good sir. So you have some like a central kitchen somewhere, right?
I have a kitchen in Chembur. But okay. during this coronavirus time, since it's a tough time, we had to raise above the clouds. I took the help of a Midtown Pritam Hotel owner. He cooked 10,000 meals every day in Dadar. Another Harish Prabhu at Goregaon. He cooked about 5,000 meals a day. And one more hotel, which was closed in Borivali, 90 feet road, they also cooked 3,000-4,000 meals and delivered. So what we did was, we asked all the agencies and the others to come to those four focal points and collect food and go to their lanes and by lanes and deliver food. Because for us, to serve 37,000 meals was a little more difficult because we could not enter Dharavi and various other places. We are prohibited. So we use the local people to come collect 500, 800, 2,000 meals and deliver to those people. That's how we worked.
Okay. So Kaz, what I know currently, how many people are you feeding now?
Now 20,000. Now 20,000. As on today, today's 20,000 people. Yesterday was 20,000 people. But when the migrant workers, when they come back, if they're asking for food, we will take it up to 40,000 if there is a need. I have the wherewithal to do okay. all these things. We'll rise okay. up to the occasion. It's a question of demand and supply. If there is a demand, I will supply. Like today, okay. just now before coming, I gave 5 tons of food to Raigad people yeah. who are yes. the cyclone-affected people.
Yeah, okay. So which are the areas in Mumbai you're focusing?
We are focusing on 40 locations. Mm-hmm. 40 locations, mostly all these slum-related areas. Daily, on a daily basis, before COVID, it was Tata Cancer Hospital, KEM Hospital, Trombay, Vikroli, Ghatkopar, and Dharavi, and places like that. In this case of corona, whoever comes, wherever it is, we give it to them. And we check whether they are genuine, and then we give it to them without a second question. They bring their own vehicle, they maintain social distance, and collect food and go and deliver. They take pictures and videos and send it to us for verification. Because donors, we have to give them some evidence that the food was given to them. Like, for example, Mir Foundation of Shah Rukh Khan and Juhi Chawla, they gave us 10,000 meals for 30 days. Mm-hmm. ACC Trust gave us that much of money. SR Foundation gave us, they stopped just now, but they gave us 1 ton of fresh vegetable every second day. For 60 days they gave. So for these people, we give accounting and auditing and also some proof that this was all utilized.
Okay, sir. Thank you, Mr. Shivanandan. That is great. So one of the questions that somebody is asking is that, so you're like a super cop. You're doing so much of work, social. Is there any plans to become a politician?
Never, sir. Not even my wildest nightmares in my life. I've ever been wanting to be a politician. As I told you, I wanted to be a professor. And still, I like today, this is the second presentation I do. One more at 5:30 for school children about cyber safety.
Okay.
So I keep on teaching. I speak about women's safety. So far, about 400 lectures I've given to an average of 300 young women. So to save them from disaster is my mission. So I give free lectures to people and I enjoy myself. I'm giving food. I don't know what I will become, what I will do more than this by becoming a politician. No, I don't want that tag of being a politician even for a second. Thank you very much for the offer. I'm returning the offer to you, all of you. Thank you.
Okay. So, so there is a question on what you referred to as the Jim Collins level 5 leadership model, right?
Yes, sir.
So most of the leaders, according to him, in all spheres, that is politics, administration, even corporate, have streak of what we call as megalomania and hubris, okay, meaning arrogance and the delusion of grandeur. Does this reflect on the degenerating value system in society, or do you believe that our systems are degenerating? And what's your take on that?
So there are lots of philanthropists who are doing extremely well. For example, yeah. Mr. Azim Premji, 8,000 crores he dedicated for improving the education system. So yeah. There are Narayana Murthys, there are Nandan Nilakanis, and there are so many others who are doing it. You know Warren Buffett, you know Bill Gates, Melinda.
Foundation. Yeah.
So, of course, there are controversies about all of them. People can always throw muck on people who are doing well. But, you know, Warren Buffett and various others have done wonderfully well.
Yes.
And there are a lot of people above board. And they're doing wonderfully well. Tata Trust, for that matter. I don't think there is any allegations against them. But they're there in every field, you know, hospitals and education, trusts and everywhere. So, for your question, my answer is absolutely positive. The living people want to lead a lifestyle which is much better than us, our childhood time. But then things have changed. You know, all this science and technology has made all these things affordable. It's available. During our time, it was not there, so we didn't have that. So having a good lifestyle is not a deteriorating value, as in my opinion. As long as they work hard and earn and lead a fantastic life, they deserve it. But doing a cyber crime or doing any other crime and leading a luxurious life is absolutely not done thing. If you say the values in the systems has come down, but then the deterioration is absolutely even in all walks of life. Politicians of Kamaraj or Morarji Desai or Sardar Vallabhai Patel, G.B. Pant and Rajendra Prasad, all that has gone down now. Now today, gangsters and criminals have all become chief ministers, and not all. Many have become chief ministers and home ministers and various others in the country, in the states. So that is deteriorating value. But my reply to you is very, very positive. There's so much of generosity. Like, for example, my own organization, I never asked all these people for this money, this Mir Foundation or ACCN. They themselves found out that there is some fellow doing a good job. Can we ask them? Can we help them? They did that. Yeah. So yes. I would say generosity is good. So many universities, colleges, scholarships, all of them are coming. My only point is youngsters who are listening to this, they should also set up systems and return 10% of what they earn and educate, give a helping hand to a poor boy to come up and study well. If that is done, obviously the whole world would be a better place to live in, sir.
Absolutely, sir. I think if we change one person, it could be a different
incidentally,
world.
Incidentally, yeah, you've given me a chance. I built a Thane police school. If anybody is living in Thane, please ask them to go visit the school and tell you. I collected the money from friends like you and Mani and various others. I built a 70,000 square feet school where there was a school of 82 children and one teacher and four classes from 1920 to 2005. In 1 year, I collected money from public without government money, with the government approval, at 70,000 square feet, and there are 3,000 children studying. Policemen are half children are police, 1,500. They pay 25%. And from 2006 to now, in 10th standard, they get only first class and distinction.
Super, super, sir. Fantastic.
Can't you change the society like this? Yeah. People who are listening to me can just adopt one child, go to a municipal school, adopt the best child, and pay for the education, books, notebooks, and uniform. That's it.
Yeah,
I have changed. Great. I have changed. I built a school in Gadchiroli. That is that Naxal affected area. One more in Chandrapur. Third one in Thane. I request all of you to visit ThanePoliceSchool.com is a website. See what a glorious school it is. It is run by a private organization and the police pays 25% because I spend the capex. Capital expenditure is from my side. The return is 75% concession. And what is the result they are getting? The other day I saw a boy called Mihir Shinde. He is studying in second year of BITS Pilani. His father is a constable today in Thane Police.
Wow.
I felt so happy about it. Yes, for changing absolutely. Their lives.
Yes, yes.
You can do absolutely. It. You can do it. All of you who are listening to me can do it. Very easily do it. Yeah. Walk into a BMC school, ask the headmaster who is the best student and pay for his fees, uniform and other things. Imagine what happens.
Absolutely, sir. I think it's all a matter of the way you think, the way you your thoughts are. If you wear glass, obviously you're going to see different shades of this thing. But if you don't wear glass, it's a different aspect. So it's all one's thoughts is what I would give the answer to that. So we have come to the end, but I have one or two questions. Are you okay to take the questions?
Yeah, bilkul, sir. Bilkul.
Okay. Thank you, sir. So, you know, you have had a responsibility, which is, you know, like, stress must be bursting out of from you all over. And so what is your recipe for staying calm and, you know, handling depression?
You know, that story which I told you, turnaround story of 98-2001, the inevitable high blood pressure and diabetes crept in. Since then, I am on tablet. I walk 10,000 steps a day. Even today, morning I have done 5,000, evening I have to do 5,000. So, I've not gone to insulin. I take only a tablet, morning one, evening one, and I live. But then, what is the recipe? Is to be wise enough to know what you can change and what you cannot change. In Tamil, there is a proverb which says, Anjivadu anjamai pedamai. It is so foolish not to be afraid of something about which you should be afraid. That's the meaning of that thing. Mani, Mamalan will explain that more to you one day. So, that is the wisdom. Oh God, give me the wisdom and the power to change what I can change. I told you what I can change, I changed. But what I cannot change, for example, a lot of people ask me, why didn't you go to Pakistan and kill Daud Ibrahim? My answer is, it is not my mandate. I can't go to Pakistan. I don't have a passport. I never went abroad. Where do I go to Pakistan and do such a thing, kind of a thing? So, what is possible is possible. What is not possible is not possible.
Correct.
So, I was at peace with what I could. I committed a lot of mistakes, I must tell you. While doing all this success story, I committed, fell down many times. I hurt myself, learned my lessons, corrected it. This winning story did not develop in one day. It developed over years. And this strategy which I used in Mumbai is not exactly opposite is used in Gadchiroli. There you can't do an encounter. If you do an encounter, then you will get hundreds of youngsters joining the Naxalite area. Then you have to change their minds. You give them education, give them development, bring them in the mainstream. So it's a totally different thing. So that understanding of what is, you are a Rambo somewhere and you are a Robin Hood somewhere and you are somewhere else, something else. If all that is understood by you and you understand your own philosophy as to what exactly you can do and what exactly you cannot do, that I think you are at peace with yourself. By the end of the story, sir, by after retirement or otherwise, if you look back and do not regret that what you have done is anything is wrong or illegal or bad, or what you don't regret that I should have done this, but I did not do that. If that kind of a regret is not there, you lead a happy life. I think you have done everything. All that life could ask or all that the life could give, you have done that. In my opinion, I am a very, very happy man. I have done what I can do and I have given to the society what has given to me, and I am very, very happy about it.
Thank you, sir. I think, sir, we have already exceeded your time. Yeah, we respect your time and we don't want to take more of your this thing. I'm sure there will be a lot, many more questions that will come. So I think, ladies and gentlemen, I think to sum up, I think Mr. Shivanandan gave us seven fantastic thoughts, okay? That is, create vision, have passion, courage, character, competence, self-image, discipline. I think these are something that he has stressed upon. If you want to have a successful career or you want to be a successful entrepreneur, these are some of the thoughts that you should have. And above all, the humility is something that's important. You know, don't look down upon people and, you know, treat them at par and bring them up, bring them on board. You know, that's the thought process that Mr. Shivanandan has given us. He leaves us with these great thoughts. I think, Mr. Shivanandan, thank you very, very much for coming to our show, spending some time with us. And it is a really, you know, a great time that I think everybody has learned a lot. And, you know, your courage and discipline that you have brought to the table, I'm sure many would like to emulate and follow. And we will be happy to invite you whenever you have the time. We will be happy to once again invite you and talk to us, sir. Thank you very much.
There is a great book called Chanakya's Seven Secrets of Leadership on this subject, which I spoke.
Yes.
Dr. Radhakrishna Pillai and me have co-authored it. 1 lakh copies have been sold.
Yes.
If people can buy and read, then they would learn a lot, sir.
Right,
Chanakya's Seven Secrets of Leadership.
Right, sir. Thank you very much. We'll do that, sir. Thank you very much. Great, sir. Jai Hind.
Have a great day and Jai Hind, Jai Maharashtra.
Thank you. Jai Maharashtra.